Hey everybody, welcome to Jet City. It's time we got to your questions answered number 80. Now, there's a list of these questions in a playlist called Your Questions Answered. I really recommend that if you have a question, go through the index. It takes some time because there's 80 videos, each with 5 or 6 questions. You will find the answer to your question there. If it's not there, it's going to be in this video or an upcoming video. But basically, any question that gets asked that has been answered many times before and asked 100 times before, I'm just going to ignore it. I'm sorry, I don't mean to be rude, but I could spend my entire life re-answering the same question over and over. Not going to do that. Okay, here's a good one. By Dog2007LOL. Dog2007LOL. And this came to me in private messages, which is like email on YouTube. If you don't have a user account, well, you do have a user account. There's a place where it says send message. If you use send message, it'll go to that person, and it's private. Nobody else can see it. So I don't like to answer technical questions in that forum, because then somebody else might ask the exact same question 5 minutes later. We like to do it in public here so that everybody can share from the answers. And the only reason I'm asking this or answering this question is because it's a good one. Otherwise, it would just languish in messages, never to be seen again. The proper place to ask a question is in the comments to a video. If you really want to, you can put it in my channel discussion, but nobody goes there. I check there once a week or so. Okay, Dog2007LOL. He says, greetings from Norway. Have you ever worked on a DLE version of the LM2500? No, but I've worked on a DLE version of the RB211. Could you maybe talk about the DLE system on these gas generators in a video of yours? Okay. DLE stands for dry low emissions. One of the ways to lower emissions with a gas turbine engine is to inject water into it, because that lowers the temperature of combustion. It also increases the mass flow, and it allows, because of the lower temperature, more fuel to be burned, so you get more power and usually less NOx emissions. You get more CO2 emissions because you're just burning fuel. If you burn carbon, you get carbon dioxide emissions, there you go, out the back. But the hotter the combustion and the longer the combustion temperature stays hot, the more you're going to get nitrates, oxides of nitrogen, NOx, they call it, NOx, because the X stands for several different numbers, 2, 3, whatever. That's known as air pollution, smog, it's the bad stuff. It's the stuff that contributes most to air pollution. So, where I work, we have a pair of LM2500 plus G4 DLE. And that shit is complicated to understand fully how all the fuel valves, etc. work to make the magic happen. Well, it's complicated in the outside. There's a lot more fuel lines because what they're trying to do is burn the fuel not in one location but many small locations to even out the burning. Instead of having one super hot spot, you want to have a whole field of little hot spots. But that's only part of it. The DLE conversions are done to what are known as aeroderivative gas turbine engines. There is an engine used for industrial purposes that's based on this one, the GEF-404, and it's called the LM-1600. We don't see much of it, but it is an industrial engine. So, when you design an engine for an aircraft, you want it to be as lightweight as possible, not necessarily as short as possible, but when you make an engine smaller, you usually make it lighter. So the combustor liner is made as compact and tight as possible in an aircraft engine. But to lower the emissions, you want to burn the fuel at a lower temperature, and that usually means a longer combustion chamber or a combustor area, longer so the fuel can take longer to burn at the speed that it's traveling. Okay, so how do you do that? If you take a gas turbine engine out of an aircraft, what you don't want to do is make the cases longer, make the shafts longer, and make everything longer, because then it's an entirely new engine. You have to redesign everything. So what can you do? You can take the combustor, oh, there's right behind you. I might turn the camera around in a minute. The combustor cases, or the combustion chambers, if you will, the combustor cases are a certain size from the front to the back, and there you go, if they're straight. Well, what you can do is you can, if this is the inlet, let's say this is the inlet of the engine and this is the outlet of the combustor, the gases are going this way, why not make the combustion gases go in this huge loop, up and then back and then out. So the physical length of the engine hasn't changed, but the length of combustion pathway of the gases is now about triple. That's exactly what you want. You want more air mixing, more time, lower temperature, and so you can burn the gases. Is it more efficient? It's not necessarily more efficient, but it produces less oxides of nitrogen because the temperature is lower. So that's what a DLE is. We don't have any DLEs here, but you can look it up on the internet and find excellent pictures. Essentially what it does is it makes the combustion pathway of the gas is longer without physically changing the length of the engine. And it also provides more precise pre-mixing and mixing of the fuel. It's got a lot more different fuel controls and fuel nozzles, and it is just to reduce emissions, dry, low emissions. Otherwise, the rest of the engine is exactly the same. Okay, like I promised, this is an Arenda Type 10. Type 10? It's a Type 10. Looks exactly like a 14 on the outside. That's why I have to remind myself. Anyway, these are the combustor outer chambers, the combustor outer cases. You could call it a combustion chamber, but it is not an enclosed volume ever. So we try not to call it a chamber. We call it a combustor or a combustion area or a combustion volume, the combustor outer case with the combustor liner inside. But you can see the air goes in here and goes straight out there. How could we make this engine longer without making the engine longer? How do we do that? Well, you could make this thing into a big, huge loop, because in a ground power operation, you've got lots of room. You put this thing on a stand in a great big installation with room. You make whatever room you need. So you could have this thing coming out, have a great big long loop, and it goes back in there. And that would be a big awkward thing that wouldn't work in an aircraft, but you're not in an aircraft. And that would allow a longer pathway of combustion for the gases, allowing more complete combustion at a lower temperature. It's what you want for low emissions. Dry, low emissions without water. Now, does anybody use a DLE configuration with water? I don't know. I don't know that. Very good question about dry, low emissions combustors. Okay, this one is by Todd Dembski, who we've heard from before. And he's talking about the turbojet test runs with instruments video, which you should take a look at. It's one where I try to explain more about what's going on with the computer screen, monitoring all the different parameters that we monitor during a test. And he says, now that was a very cool video. It was interesting to watch the operator move the power lever and the lag of the turbine RPM and the thrust values. Be careful with that, Todd Dembski, because with the J79, you can move the throttle slowly, and it comes up slowly. Also, when you're at idle, ground idle RPM, it does take a long time for the engine to pick up speed to, say, flight idle. Flight idle is about 85% RPM. Between flight idle and max power, the engine basically responds like a light switch. It's instant. There's a massive amount of power at hand, and about 1,500 pounds of rotating mass, but there is you want to call it turbo lag? There isn't any. It's like a lightning bolt. The J79 is legendary amongst pilots and the aviation community for its throttle response. But all gas turbine engines have a response time that changes. From idle to just above idle, it takes a long time. But in the so-called power band, the working range of powers that the aircraft operates in, there's no lag. It's instant. Like I talked about with the T-58, the free power turbine, water jet powered race boat. you'd think there'd be a lag. You know, you'd spin up the gas generator, it takes a while for the power turbine to gain speed and power the boat. There is no lag whatsoever. If you're at 85% and you slam it to 100%, it feels like you've been rear-ended by a dump truck. It's instant. So, yes. When you're looking at videos, it's important to know exactly what's going on about the way the jet engine responds. And when it's in its operating regime in the air, the J79 and all fighter jet engines for that matter, they don't really have any lag to speak of. Not that you can see as watching somebody work the throttle. And he goes, I was surprised that at ground idle you were still putting out over 500 pounds of thrust. Well, 500 pounds over, about 11,000 dry pounds of thrust before you get into afterburner. 500 over 11,000 is 1/22nd. So what's that, about 5%? Making about 5% power at idle, which I guess is a little bit more than an idling outboard motor on a boat. But 500 pounds of thrust is not a whole lot for an engine that makes 11,000. Well, I guess it's a little bit. It's moving a lot of air. It has to move a lot of air just to idle. And you're saying ground idle? Ground idle on the J79 is 5,000 RPM. So it may have been a little bit higher than that. As soon as you start increasing the revs, it's a big engine. It moves a lot of air. You start to make more and more push. So just a little bit, it's a big engine. Remember, it's a big, nasty engine. All right. I know, looks the same, different. This is number two. I will try to film the test of this engine like I tried and failed the last one. No promises. Everybody's busy, I'm busy. Hopefully I'll be here when it's being run. I'll try to. All I can do is promise. Okay. And thanks to Steve H, we have interesting question number three. I'll start with a sigh. It would be real good to put a chain link fence around the front end of the building out past the suction zone to help prevent FOD from occurring and to keep inattentive humans / animals out of the suction zone. Don't need to see anyone / thing being sucked through a blender turned sideways. ! Just a thought. ! Okay, first of all, there is no such thing as suction. Look it up. Don't argue with me. Talk to your physics teacher. Talk to your physics professor. There is no such thing as suction. If you can't get your head around that, please just stop and move on to the cat videos. All right. Now, a chain link fence around the front of the building. First of all, this comes in on a trailer, and we use that crane over there, which is on casters, to pick it up to mount it in the skid. A chain link fence would be in the way. We couldn't use a helicopter to move the engine into place because it's too expensive. And there's a roof right there, so we can't drop a chain through. So your chain link fence would be the worst idea possible next to a moat filled with burning oil. So no, it would be a really bad idea. And a chain link fence to help prevent FOD from occurring, foreign object damage, or FOD damage is foreign object debris damage, whatever you want to call it. How would a chain link fence stop that? Anything that's going to be moved into the engine, I was going to say sucked, but it's not sucked, it's pushed by the fact that the air pressure is lowered by this thing and the air pressure is higher over there, and air will always move from an area of high pressure to low pressure. There you go. Gum wrappers, Kleenex, rags, hats, small animals would go through a chain link fence and they don't get sucked into the engine. So the chain link fence would prove to be useless if it was needed, and it's not needed, so it's useless times being useless. As I've told people before, that instruct me what I need to do here. It's been 10 years since I started here testing engines. It's not my engine test cell. They're not my engines. But I am here for a lot of engine tests. Nothing has ever been sucked in or has been moved in by higher air pressure going into lower pressure area zones. Nothing has been pulled off the ground into the engine, ever. What we do, as I explain in the comments all the time, is we have an engine at about the same height, and with the same protective material in front of it as that on your friendly neighborhood 737 on the runway. How do they do it? They keep the runway clean. How do we do it? We keep our front concrete pad cleaner than a runway. Absolutely. Look at that. I'm gonna pick this up now. That is a section of a zip tie. And this was found right there. But guess what? Before this engine is run, several people sweep this place and use compressed air and clean it. Not quite as clean that you can eat off it, but almost that clean. So nothing has gone into an engine. I think once I saw a bumblebee go in, but a chain link fence wouldn't stop that. So many test cells use a large screen in front of the engine. We are developing another one of those because our last one started to crack. We didn't want to suck aluminum bits into the engine, so we don't have it here. But we do practice the same thing that is done on airports and aircraft carriers, and that is to keep the ground in front of the engine clean. It works. Now, inattentive humans. There aren't any inattentive humans here during an engine test. There aren't. We will not allow it. If some inattentive humans or people that didn't know what was going on were running around like crazy, there's a little handle in the control room that you just pull back and it shuts the engine off. That's what you do. Never happened. Hopefully it never will, but we are prepared for inattentive humans with procedural modifications to the test. We'll shut it down. Animals don't approach a running jet engine because sometimes animals are smarter than people. It's a loud screaming machine. We've never seen a bird, a squirrel, a mouse, a deer, or a moose, or a black bear approach the engine when it's running. Don't need to see anyone / thing being sucked through a blender turned sideways. Well, okay. It's not a blender turned sideways, but it's got things that rotate and it's got choppy bits and it wouldn't be good to go in there, but that's why nothing does. So thanks for the thought, but we've had good success with the system we have. We are going to continue to do so. So thanks for that. We get this comment every freaking week. Every freaking week. Yeah. Thanks, Steve H. Question number 5 is by Ross Payton. It's a bit of a long one. I hope this is not too off topic, but after what you had to say about flight versus ground engines and the many advantages that you spoke about concerning modern, purposely designed industrial engines having less complexity, better fuel efficiency, longer service intervals, and less maintenance overall, it's difficult for me to see the justification for continuing the use of these aircraft-derived engines. So in other words, he's saying, these days, there are modern, purpose-built industrial engines and aircraft engines. Why do we still use old engines that are the industrial version of an aircraft engine? Okay. I really enjoy watching your videos and think it is great that you take the time to do this in such a clear and very concise and easy to understand way. For example, I've never understood why the fan wasn't turning. Well, I've never wondered why the fan wasn't turning. Anyway, I'd like to really hear your take on this issue. Okay, lots more words. Okay, basically, there is a good reason for using an old engine that is a slightly modified aircraft engine versus a brand new engine that is specifically designed to be an industrial engine. And that is money. This engine was designed in the 60s, and it's an industrial version of the Rolls-Royce Spey. The Rolls-Royce Spey is a very complex solution to a problem, possibly more so than is necessary. Yes, Graham, I'm talking to you. The Rolls-Royce Spey makes around between 15 and 20,000 horsepower, just like an LM1500. I think it's more fuel efficient, which doesn't matter in an industrial engine, but it does matter in an aircraft. So why do we use this in an industrial situation? That's because once you bought it in 1970 or 75 or 82 or 1990 or whenever you bought it, it's cheaper to keep it running than it is to throw it away and buy a new one. We're talking $20 million to replace this versus between $400,000 and $1 million to overhaul it. So let's say $1 million versus $20 million. That's a big difference on a budget sheet. So that's the difference. Well, that's the reason. The industrial engines, once you have it, you can keep it going almost forever, or you can replace it. So if you're going to start a new, from the ground up power plant in 2016, which is when I'm filming this, videoing this, there's no film anymore, 2016, you could go to GE, Rolls-Royce, Pratt & Whitney, or a number of other manufacturers, solar, other people, and you could say, look, I want a 15 megawatt gas generator, and I want it now. And they'll charge you $20 million and give you a beautiful piece of industrial hardware that will last forever, be easier to service than an aircraft engine, and be very fuel efficient, and it'll be heavy. So that'll mean it'll mean it's durable. It's a good thing. You can also go to a manufacturer and say, I want a 25,000 pound thrust jet engine for my fighter jet. And they will supply you with a lightweight, high performance, amazing jet engine. Those are two totally different lanes of traffic. Nothing about them is the same in any way. But back in the day, you would get either an industrial version or an aerospace version of the same core engine. If you went with this, it's better to keep it than to throw it away. That's basically the only reason. Why justify the use of these old engines? Because you have them. If you have a 1967 Corvette in your garage and it needs a tune-up and it's got four flat tires, does it pay to spend a couple thousand dollars getting it running, wash it up and go take it for a cruise? Or should you go buy a brand new Corvette? Be nice to have the brand new Corvette, but you have a 67 in your driveway. So you wouldn't want to throw it away, would you? It's the same idea. Millions and millions and millions of dollars to replace it, hundreds of thousands of dollars to keep it going, and it still works just fine. This industrial engine will not quite be as efficient as a brand new one, but for the $20 million you're saving, that goes a long way. Also, there's other reasons. Sometimes there's a power plant in certain areas of the country, the US, Canada, Europe, whatever, and there are air regulations that have been put in place for air pollution and emissions, and it states right in the license or the agreement or whatever you want to call it, the permit to operate that engine, it states that the engine must not be modified. So if you have a 1969 Spey 101, something like that, it has to be a 1969 Spey 101 that you put back in there when you take it out. You can't sneak in something new. And we have engines in parts of the world where specific model numbers cannot be changed. Combustor liners, igniters, exhaust nozzles, compressors, they all must be exactly what's listed on the paperwork, even if the newer stuff is better. because the contract states that it must not be changed. It's all legal stuff. I don't know. It's the way it goes in the world. But if you've got a spay in your power plant and you want to replace it with a Siemens, probably won't fit. But if it does, you've got to essentially throw this away or scrap it or sell it and then buy the new Siemens engine, which is going to be expensive. Worth it, but expensive. So use what you got. Keep it going. It's way cheaper than buying new. That's the way it is. That's why, Ross Payton, that we use these old engines. And they're aircraft versions. They're a good compromise between power and durability. They lean more towards the power and less towards the durability. But they're, because aircraft gas turbine engines are so amazingly reliable, they work well as industrial power plants. Hey, now for the last question is by someone somewhere. Someone somewhere out there. A few questions on the fuel engine controllers. What difference is there between the fuel controllers on industrial versus aircraft engines? Is it the same part or different? Do the industrial engines just get fuel or no fuel? I thought gas turbines needed fairly active fuel controllers to be stable. This is a lot of questions. What kind of throttle linkages are on an industrial engine? Is it just off idle full? If it's off idle full, then there's a progressive control. And it, no, cable-based system like non-FADEC aircraft engines, do you know what this gets connected to on the installation side? Yeah, we've covered this before. Basically, this is not an aircraft engine, but if it was, there would be some kind of a linkage with a cable, possibly electronic, to the lever that the pilot controls. And as we've said before, the pilot does not control the engine. Much as he thinks he does not control the engine. The pilot gets to vote. The pilot says, I want to go faster. The engine says, okay, let's do that. And the engine controls how to increase throttle. Decrease, increase, whatever. The pilot makes a request. The fuel control meets that request, which is the best way the engine can handle it. Now, the industrial engine, the throttle control you can't see because it's underneath the skid there and it's all bolted and there's stuff bolted on top of it. I can't get at it. It's basically a big black box, which is a fuel valve that's controlled by a computer. The computer senses exhaust gas temperature, exhaust gas pressure because it's going into a power turbine, engine RPM, possibly fuel flow, air temperature, and barometric pressure. And it also senses demand. There's probably a manual control, but there's no lever. It's with a computer keyboard. And it's also, if it's generating electricity, it's hooked into a computer that senses electrical demand. Or it just maintains an output voltage as best it can. So the fuel control is not in any way controlled by a person. It's an automatic system that's designed to either pump natural gas or supply electricity. There's no need to have a person monitoring it except the operator of the power plant or pumping station monitors the alarms. If there's a vibration alarm, a temperature alarm, a fuel pressure alarm, an RPM alarm, there's all these alarms that will go off if there's a problem. Then the operator has to deal with it in some way or another. The most dangerous thing you can do, and you can see this on the internet, and I'll tell you about that in just a second. There's a spay. It's a Rolls-Royce spay in a shipping stand, and there's guys there with a ball valve to the fuel. And you know how you can tell that's dangerous? Because those guys are so scared, they don't even get the engine to idle. You can hear the engine spool up a bit, and they back it off, spool up a bit, back it off. If they were to slam open that ball valve, holy crap. First of all, that shipping stand with the engine would be zooming down off the field, be pulling against the fuel line, it'd be just disaster, be an absolute disaster. So that engine doesn't even get to idle. Never, ever, ever give a human direct control over fuel to a gas turbine engine or you will destroy it. You will destroy it. Okay. It's all computerized and automated and has no direct human control except possibly typing it in a computer to increase the RPM. Okay? There is no cable, there's no linkage. Anyway, it's a very sophisticated fuel control. Industrial engines are computer controlled and automated with some slight intervention by the operators. And I'm not an absolute expert on the systems that run them, but I know there's no gas pedal and no handle. There's no guy controlling the power. They're automated. They're an automated machine, a lot like a giant electric motor in a process factory making steel or car parts or computer chips or whatever. Okay. Someone somewhere. That was good. In front of a Rolls-Royce Spey that I hope to film video running soon. Thanks for watching.